Magazine's articles and books on musicianship and the art of bass playing. Chairman of the Electric Bass Department of the Richard Davis Foundation for Young Bassists, Incorporated, and on the advisory board of the 144 Music and Arts Organization. His latest books and articles and videos, There's Music in Everyone, The Wake Up Call, Human Livestock, Make Your Groove Happen, and Jamboree. Please welcome Mr. Jerry Jemmott, Georgia Bass Players. In the last 100 years, that's a very powerful line. It really is.
It's a response to what I did. It's a response to my effort to just make it happen, really. I'm going to begin this with a quote by Eddie Harris. Eddie Harris said, "Music is the only industry where you can become successful and not know what you're doing." And I would be the poster child for that. In spite of not knowing what I was doing, through my passion and commitment to wanting to play and wanting to share, I was fortunate to play with some very good people coming up.
Where did it begin for you? In the early days, and what inspired you to play bass? And what got you involved with music?
Paul Chambers.
Yeah.
Two words, Paul Chambers, followed by Charles Mingus, followed by Errol Garner, Count Basie, and then I started going backwards in time to Fats Waller, Earl Hines, all the big bands, Jimmy Lunsford, Cab Calloway, bassist Jimmy Blanton. But I was more inspired by the music of my time coming up in the 50s. Cannibal Adderley, John Coltrane, Miles Davis. That music was what I was, wanted to play that music straight ahead. But I had the roots from the swing. I had that music in me. I started playing in local bands, Latin bands, swing bands. I even played in a marching band. I played the symphony orchestras as coming up in junior high school, the All City High School Orchestra.
So there was music in the schools.
There was music in the schools back then. In fact, I came up during the era of the Newport Youth Band. People like Alan Rubin, you see from the Blues Brothers, Eddie Gomez, Lou Marini. No, he wasn't in the band. Harry Hall, Micah Benny, Andy Marsala, Nat Pavone. These are the guys. Larry Rosen, the great drummer, who made Blues and Rosen Records. Great musicians, and there was a climate where they were supporting music. We would go out and play the rehearsal bands, just read charts, and never intend to make a gig. Just the rehearsal band, just to practice, hone our skills.
And just to play music. And
just to play music.
And what was it about Paul Chambers when you heard him perform that was almost like probably had a level of spirituality for you?
Oh, it was. It was his rhythmic pulse, his improvisation, his interpretation of the groove. The way he would be able to add things to it, his pickups and lead-ins and fills. You know, these things I'm saying now, but back then I didn't know what they were. Right. I just said, oh, that sounds good, I want to do that, you know. And that's what I was, that was my cry to become part of society at that point. Because as a kid I was very withdrawn, I didn't want to do anything. I participate, but I never want to initiate anything. So that brought me out.
Were there other musicians other than bass players that you found solace in that you had to listen to?
Oh, Carmen McRae.
Oh, Carmen, I wish you.
You know, it's train Sonny Horace Silver. It was almost like the bodies of music I would listen to, like Fats Waller, Horace Silver, the big bands. It wasn't just one musician, it was a total collaboration of making music together as a band, those units, and the music they made that really inspired me. And I didn't have the ability to really hear the individual instruments. I don't have a good ear that most musicians have. And so as a result of it, I had to make up my own music. That's how I developed my style. I couldn't hear what they played, I couldn't copy it, you know? So I had to, in the style of, similar to, and they said, hey, that's pretty good. They like what I played as opposed to copying somebody else. So I continued developing along those paths, you know? But it comes a point in time where you have to play like somebody else, so I have to read the ink. You know, I was able to do both that and put my artistic approach to it. I learned to do both after a while.
So what was it about you know, were there any teachers that you studied with at an early age that guided you, or was it just listening?
It was basically listening. Like I look back now, I listen like a listener. I wouldn't try to figure out what they were playing. I couldn't hear. I mean, I couldn't make out nothing what they were playing. I just absorbed the sound and feeling of the music. And this got into the spirit of what was going on.
And reading music, how did you learn how to read music?
My first teacher taught me how to read music. He's a piano player. And I would read the music and how would I be, oh, Volare was a big song at the time. Volare, oh. That was the big hit at the time.
Dean Martin, big time.
Yeah, big time hit. So I was the first tune I learned.
So and was it, were you taking piano lessons or were you taking?
No, I was playing bass. He was teaching me how to read and play the bass. He was a piano teacher who had some knowledge of the fingering of the bass. And he had a book that he brought to me, and he'd come to my house. I had a bass, and he was my first teacher. And after a year, I stopped taking lessons, and I started working.
What was your first gig?
The group was Smiling Henry and the Rhythm Makers. I was playing at a local boys club. Somehow, I walked over there about a mile from my house with my bass. I had it on a wheel, so I rolled my bass. After playing a couple hours, I guess, at a rehearsal, I happened to go outside in the hallway, and I was approached by some men who asked me if I would join their band. I said, wow, that's first for me to ever be offered to join a band. And they said, that's all to be fine with me, to ask my mother. So they drove me home.
You were how old?
I was 12.
What?
They drove me home, went upstairs, and introduced it to my mother. And she said, Jerry, this is what you want to do. I said, sure do. And that was it. That began my professional career.
And what kind of tunes did you play in that first game?
I'm trying to think of Wonderful, You Wonderful, Marvelous. Society tunes, standards, basically. Now, taking in mind, now, I had a bad ear. Okay, but I must have some kind of feel going on that I could get by making out the notes and fake my way through these songs. And after a while, I learned the songs. I was playing more accurately. But it was stressful. I mean, I didn't look at it as being stressful, but when you learn like that, it is stressful. And after a while, you have to find a better way. Find a better way.
You say you didn't have an ear, yet what you hear when you play, you always play the right notes, you play them in the right places, you're always an incredible tune. What do you mean like you didn't have an ear?
Well, I couldn't distinguish the notes. But I had a feel for where they should be, what they should sound like, and I had a sense of like, I knew the scales, I knew what the notes were in the instrument, so I play them randomly what I thought should be played at a certain time.
I wish in my life I had 10% of your ability to not be able to hear a tune. I'd be a much better musician.
Well, you got to trust the unknown. Well, you embrace the unknown.
But that's powerful. You say to embrace the unknown. So
I always have.
You had some kind of an inner drive that allowed you to trust your instinct.
Yeah, and I would have visions of what would play out in my head about, you know, the circumstances, the sound, the title of the song. I would try to bring that to life. So I would feel the music for what it, everything that it had in it, not just the bass part, but everything that was around it.
That's powerful. So you go from this band and you start to meet other musicians. This was this in the Bronx.
Everybody in the band played in another band, so they would hire me to play in the other side band. So I was playing from one band, I'd end up joining four different bands.
And about what year was this?
This would be 1958.
Late 50s.
59.
So the music was starting to really evolve and get powerful, and the whole jazz thing into the rock thing.
It came into the jazz, went into soul. People like Horace Silver, Cannonball Adderley were making music that people could, you know, pop their fingers to and move their butt, you know. Mm-hmm. People were liking this, the music in the clubs. It was powerful to be around the CD evolution of the music at the time.
And who were some of the bands that you started to listen to? Did you go to concerts at that time? Was there a lot going on as musically?
I was too busy working to go to concerts. Yes. I was working 3-4 nights a week. Okay. And doing this from junior high school through high school.
Did you get involved in any jam sessions? Did they have that going on too at the course of that time?
Well, of course. We had, I would go out to Brooklyn, take the train and the bus, walk to the train, take the train, another train, three trains and a bus, to go to James Hunter's house out in Brooklyn, or Billy Hoffman's house, or Artie Sterling's house, who was the nephew of Roy Haynes. Okay, so between Billy would be over there playing, James would be playing the piano, I'd be playing the bass, great Frank Mitchell, he would be there. A lot of guys from my, who else was there? Richie, Phil Namathworth, a lot of guys from, I went to Deacon Clinton High School, so it wasn't a music school, but we had musicians that played. Frank was my classmate. And so we'd go to jam sessions all over the city, in the Village, Brooklyn, Queens. You name it, you know, have baseball travel.
Yeah.
This is when I'm not working now. Meanwhile, things came to mind. I was working 3 or 4 nights, so I had to do this like on Sunday, Monday, when I wasn't working.
That's pretty powerful. You mentioned Billy Cobham.
Yeah.
Billy Cobham, who just recently turned 70 years young, and who was at the forefront of his career, playing on the road, Gary Hunt was on keyboard, playing great and still doing it. It's amazing how you were able to connect with such powerful musicians, really, who became great, great players.
It's truly him. Eddie Gomez was in the same class. He was my only competition. And, you know, people talk about having big hands. And I say, I grew up with Eddie Gomez. He's about this big.
Yeah, he's like,
you know, and about the size of the hand. Yeah. It's like knowing where the notes are and having a feel for the music. He had a profound sense of time and feel for music. I mean, he was always incredible. Uh-huh. Always incredible. I was 14, he was 16.
So you start getting involved with playing some musicians. You had mentioned earlier about Aretha Franklin, that you haven't played with her in a long, long time. And now you're back to playing on the Letterman Show, I believe you said, at the end of this month.
Right.
How powerful that is.
That's crazy.
What was it like when you first started working with
her? Well, the first time it's a short story, but just to show you how you have to be prepared and ready. I was called to come down to Atlantic Studios and observe a session with Aretha Franklin. This is 1968. And I brought my bass down, I'm sitting in the control room, and they're working out this song, and from V1, I heard the way I thought it should be done. They were doing it another way. The session started at 10 o'clock to 10 to 1, take a lunch break, come back from 2 to 5. So, between 10 and 1, they still hadn't gotten it, and I'm going crazy. Because at that point, Aretha Frank was the love of my life. You know, I would go into Columbia Records where I do sessions, and there'd be a big picture up in the control room, and I'd just go in there just to see the picture between takes. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd go to the headphones, stand outside the studio, play my part, get out the studio. But in Columbia 30th Street, I have to go in the control room. So that's what I
got. See the picture. Did you ever tell her that?
No, but I'm going to tell her that when I see her. So in 68, I did the session. After we recorded Think, we did it in 2 takes. Tommy Cogdo, great bass player, he was playing lead guitar. He switched over to playing lead guitar. And after he finished playing the song, he said, "No, man, you stay here. You play the bass for the rest of the session." He stayed on the guitar. So in between next takes, she tried to hire me to join her band to travel. And I had a vision of being a studio musician. So I could not, you know, lose my seat, basically, because when you leave town, people think you're going forever. They don't call you. So, and I was already doing sessions with different people. and I didn't want to lose my spot, so I declined the job, you know, but I continued making records for her,
yeah.
You know, up until 71 when King Curtis died. So now 45 years later, she sees my picture and says, oh, he's still alive, huh? I'll call him to do the Letterman show. Because our regular guy, Ralph Armstrong, he couldn't make it. He's doing something in Tennessee for his father, or something festival for his father.
Ralph,
so he couldn't make the gig. But they knew a long time ago he couldn't make the gig. They never hired anybody until he sent the picture of me and him together in Germany at the Warwick base camp. And she said, she told H.G. Barnum, you know, find him. And he found me. And next Monday, I'll be on Letterman show.
Yeah. How crazy the world works.
It's crazy. It's really crazy.
You mentioned King Curtis. What are your memories about with King Curtis?
Oh, so many good things. Besides the playing, he gave me a spiritual awakening. I tell people the story because it's really profound when things happen in your life. I didn't have a spiritual background, let's just say belief. I believed in cause and effect, you know, but it was only about the present. And when he died on Friday the 13th, August 13th, 1971, his manager called and told me, his road manager, his valet actually, Norman Duggar, called me, told me exactly what happened, blah, 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 blah. He's dead, crying. This is 8:30 at night. 10 o'clock the next morning, my house in Yonkers, he's in my kitchen hovering above cabinets. At that point, I realized there was something more to life. So not only did he teach me in music and life, he taught me in death, you know, about life. And while he was living, he baptized me in terms of playing music. I was already playing, but he really entrenched me in the idea of performing for people and getting in what the audience wanted to hear and really just getting down and being, you know, completely free. Now, coming from a jazz background, I thought I was free, but he showed me true freedom. I never forget the day, but we were playing You Don't Miss Your Water up at the Pine Grill in Buffalo, New York, in the summer of 1967, when all this, you have these moments where things happen, and you never forget them.
Yeah.
And at that point, I was baptized, you know. At that point, I said, yeah, this is what I want to do. This is the kind of music I want to play. This is it for me.
How powerful.
Yeah, it was tremendously powerful.
He baptized you, and even in death, he resurrected you.
How about that? How about that?
That's powerful.
Yeah, it really is. I'm glad you asked me that question. Thank you.
With live from the Fillmore East.
West.
Fillmore West, correct. Memphis Soul Stew. I mean, there's the tunes that you play, but you just totally, you know, set a standard when it came to playing bass. That was really powerful.
Well, when you don't know what you know, the thing comes back where I didn't know, I couldn't hear anything else, any everybody else did. I had to make up my own stuff. So I was got in the habit of like this, making up my own parts in a way that were unique, that would make the song have more life to it. Mm-hmm. I thought with the power of the electric bass, it wasn't doing as much as it could be, because I come from playing acoustic bass,
right.
And it was different. It was, you know, you couldn't always hear it as well, which is one reason why I couldn't hear it, because in the recordings, it was low anyway.
Absolutely.
And so I'm straining the list. I'm saying, like, you know, it's in this key, and this sounds good, I'll play this.
Yeah.
So it's always been that way for me, you know, to play whatever I hear. And usually I hear a third high or a third lower than what's actually my note to be. Like the bass note would be C, I'll hear E or A, invariably.
But that can be a part of your gift.
That's just what I hear. I hear the harmony.
Yeah.
I hear the harmonic, you know, evolution as opposed to just the fundamental bass note.
Yeah.
I've learned that, you know, you go from the fundamental note and then you go into the harmonic evolution as chorus after chorus goes on. You develop, you build.
Well, that's powerful. We mentioned last night after dinner, we had a chance to meet him with George Benson and seeing him and just talking to him for a few minutes. He was in the restaurant next to us last night.
What?
Right in the restaurant next to us. Nate grabs me and says, Benson's next to us. Let's go by and say hello to him. I said, a quick hello.
What you tell me?
Nate just dragged me and pulled me.
We have the same birthday.
When is that?
I want two of his records.
Well, absolutely. When did you record with Benson?
Back in the 60s.
Yeah.
Back in, I think it was Abbey Road and something else. I don't remember exactly, you know, a couple of albums.
But here's George, another phenomenal musician who's now about 71 years young, so playing. And I mean, one of his strong influences was Wes Montgomery. Mm-hmm. And Wes, who had this incredible way of playing this melody, octave movement that was the chord structure of the song, but within the melody was extremely unique back in the 30s and 40s. Mm-hmm. And George took that and brought that really into the 20th, well, into the later 20th and 21st century, what he did. What was it like when you were working with him?
Well, George, I had known, had seen, you know, heard of and seen in the clubs around New York before he, you know, get his deal. For me, playing with an artist is always a duet. Mm. And in the studio, it's about making something unique. You're making a record, you're there for a purpose, you're making history. You know, so, okay, what can I do with him that's gonna make his product unique? You know, so it was like, let's like I do with Aretha, B.B. King. I'm gonna get into them, what they're doing. I'm gonna play a basic, I'm gonna support them, but it's gonna turn into a duet. You know, this is my style. This, you know, improvisational. Yeah. Well, I'm playing my supportive part, but I'm going back and forth between playing with the singer or the soloist in the context of me performing my duties as an accompanist. Boy, that was wonderful.
At the power, look at that. You're getting involved in playing a duet. That's really good.
You listen to most of my recordings with Thad Jones and Mel Lewis, I did stuff with Archie Shepp. And it's always, you know, it always ends up that way. It might not start that way. But at some point, I'm going to get to the mix. It's going to become a duet at some point. If it's going to be a record, it's going to happen faster sooner than later. Oh. I'm going to hear something that's going to make me swoop in on the melody at some particular point, then go back from the melody. Oh. And to give it that lift at that point.
Huge. How did you go from, and as you continue to play with all these great artists and your own band, how did you get involved in the educational end of it? Because I mean, there's music in everyone. You've got a series of books that you have out, and now you've got them as downloads in the process where you enter the 21st century very well by having it available. I mean, just as I scan through this here, this has got some great direction in the music industry. Where did this come in from as far as being involved in the educational market?
The desire to learn more, the need to learn more, first of all. I had where I wanted to go, what I wanted to do. I wanted to get into a performing career a solo career as opposed to working as a musician, become more of the artist. And I realized I needed no more. So who did I ask more but then my great friend, the great virtuoso Richard Davis? Hmm. I asked him, how do I learn more? How do I get better? He said, teach. You know, simple as that. He said, teach. And I began my teaching career in 1976.
And still going.
It's still going. Yeah. Still going.
So you had mentioned earlier in the panel that you had different points, like a 5-point structure of how you kind of look at things. Mm-hmm. Just talk about that for a second.
Okay. Now, those 5 points are basically 5 out of 10. The whole picture is actually 5 and 5, 5 plus 5. So I have 5 components and I have 5 elements. And I look at elements as being something like intangible, like, you know, quantifying the air you breathe, what you're smelling, so to speak, and the components is something physical that you can actually grasp. The components are the groove, creativity, knowledge, skill, and technique. Mm-hmm. Now, to be honest with you, I got this idea from the great basketball player, Connie Hawkins. I was listening to a radio show, and he was talking about how the team worked. And at one point, one particular player out of 5 might be the focal point. Don't give him the ball. Everybody has to work around him. You know, and at one point, another player, everybody has to work around him. So I said, man, this is deep.
Sounds like jazz.
Yeah, exactly. And so I said, that is something. And I was in the middle of writing my book, and I had some of my stuff going on. I said, okay, 5. So I began to look, you know, establish the 5 criteria, the groove, the skill, technique, knowledge, and creativity. And along with them, well, what level of influence will they have on it, depending upon the personal commitment of the person. So then I came up with passion, commitment, compassion, mental fortitude, and physical endurance. Now out of these 10 things, I realized then that I only had 4, maybe 3. Okay, but I knew they were important. In fact, that I didn't have them, I mean, that I would always not have them, so I worked to attain them. But once I identified them, it became easy. I was able to a level, I was able to even measure my commitment. What time I'm getting up in the morning? Well, if you're committed, you're gonna get up an hour early so you can get X, Y, Z done and get things done before you pick up your instrument. So you have a clear head. This is what makes you have your better focus. All these things, putting things in a line so your success will be not altered or faulted by distraction. Okay, about what I should have been doing, what I didn't do. You know, so I get things in order to take care of your priorities, then I pick up an instrument. I have a clear head. I'll be living proof of it. You know,
absolutely.
It's about revelation, explanation, and demonstration. Yeah. If I tell a student something, I'm revealing it to them. Then I explain it to them. Then I'll have the student demonstrate it. Or I will demonstrate it. Or I'll demonstrate something, then I'll tell them what it is or where it comes from. It doesn't matter which order it comes, but those three elements, those three components, those three focal points that have happened during a conversation, a revelation, explanation, and demonstration are key to having somebody have a complete learning, understanding of what it is they're doing.
Huge, absolutely huge. You know, we're here at CalArts, and we've been here all day now at the school, and it's so great to have the students hear what you're speaking about. In closing, what would you leave for the students, the thoughts, wisdom, or some advice from all your years of experience, and as you continue at an incredible pace of which you're going, what would you leave them for them to be this next generation of music bearers?
That's a good question. Explore your life. You want to figure out what lane it is. Figure out what you do best. I ask my students, give me a list of three things. What you do best, what you think you need to improve upon, and what your goals are. You answer those three questions, and then we'll come up with a course of action for you to attain your goals. So I guess it's the same thing. I mean, for them to figure out what it is they do best, whether they're a sprinter, a marathon runner, a middle distance runner, find out what your forte is. And not say that you can't do anything else, but realize where your strengths are, utilize them, and use the things that you're not strong in to build the strength. You know, everything is a scaffold. And in the same token, as you move forward, you might have a destination down the road, but don't go so fast that you can't stop and smell the roses along the way. You know, it's one thing to get the tomatoes to market fresh 2 days before everybody else, but the guy 2 days before you got after you has the same tomatoes, but he got potatoes, he got yams, he got string beans, he's got corn,
hey, I'm getting hungry.
He got some chicken, you know, and a lower price.
Absolutely.
Okay? So you just don't want to be on one thing. You want to be able to absorb on your journey, because the fun is in the getting there. Once you get there, it's about what's next. What's next? How to play it. What's next? When I think of playing, it's what's next? How to play it. What's next? How to play it. What's next? This is my constant thought when I'm on it. Sometimes I'm not on it. It's just like I'm just playing, and what's next might be whatever comes, and then I'm embracing it, and that's cool too. You leave room for things not to know and to be able to react to what's happening, as opposed to what's next, how to play it, what's next, how to play it. You know, so it's, you have to have that balance between the two modes of operation.
Very powerful. You know, you inspire me, and you really do inspire me, because when I hear you talk, it really gives me hope and encourages me to even push harder.
Well, you're pushing so hard. I hate to hear this result. Watch out, world.
You know, your book is There's Music in Everyone, and what's amazing about it is, for sure, there's music in you. I thank you so much for the time that you've given to us today and for this interview with the students. You are an absolute master, absolutely one of the finest bass players that have come along in the last 100 years.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
Jerry Jemmott, thank you so much. Let's hear it. Great job. Great stuff.